You know what time it is. It's time to learn the book. One, two, three.
These are the books of the Bible. When we read them, it makes us stronger. And we learn about our Heavenly Father. When we read all the books of the Bible. These are the books of the Bible. When we read them, it makes us stronger. And we learn about our Heavenly Father. When we read all the books of the Bible. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, just to name a few. We got Numbers, Deuteronomy, we call that the Pentateuch. Joshua, Judges, then a story about a girl named Ruth. First and Second Samuel, First and Second Kings, First and Second Chronicles, we're talking about history.
There were a couple of guys who were up to some good.
We got Ezra, Nehemiah, they helped build a wall around the neighborhood. We got Esther, Job, and Psalms. These are the books of the Bible. When we read them, it makes us stronger. And we learn about our Heavenly Father. When we read all the books of the Bible. These are the books of the Bible. When we read them, it makes us stronger. And we learn about our Heavenly Father. When we read all the books of the Bible.
Of wisdom.
We got Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, the Song of Solomon. He was a wise king.
Then we're moving right along to the majors.
Isaiah, Jeremiah, Lamentations, Ezekiel.
Daniel got thrown in the lion's den.
But he wasn't alone.
God was with him.
And then we got the minor prophets.
Hosea, Jonah, and Amos, Obadiah.
Jonah got swallowed by a big fish.
We got Titus, Philemon, and Hebrews, James, First and Second Peter. Then you got John, he was a revelator. He wrote 1, 2, 3, and then you got you. Let's close it down with Revelation. These are the books of the Bible. When we read them, it makes us stronger. And we learn about our Heavenly Father. When we read all the books of the Bible. These are the books of the Bible. When we read them, it makes us stronger. And we learn about our Heavenly Father. When we read all the books of the Bible.
I said these are the books of the Bible. When we read them, it makes us stronger. And we learn about our Heavenly Father. When we read all the books of the Bible. Yeah.
Yo, 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 that was the book, y'all.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to our Confirmation Online. We'll give this a try and see how it goes. Last time we met together, we were on worship. And so this time we're on the second strategy of discipleship and growing in our faith. And that's grow. So let's take a look. You can see here our mission statement is building believers to reach out and connect people to Jesus. In order to build you up, in order to prepare you to be able to help other people believe in Jesus and connect them to him, we want you to be able to be in worship. And then we want you, and then second strategy, to grow in your faith through different Bible studies and being part of the Word. So, there we go. To start that off, we want to think about who is your personal role model? Now, if we were in person, we'd give you time to stop and talk and think about that. But a lot of you probably would say people like your family or maybe a teacher or an athlete, somebody that you look up to. But we want to think about what makes a person a good role model. What are the things about them that make them a good role model? Is it how they act? Is it what they do? Is it how they treat you? And so obviously that perfect role model, who we want to model our life after, would be Jesus, you know, who was perfect and blameless and still took away all of our sins. Jesus makes a good role model of how we should treat other people and how we should act and how we should behave. We want to think about when we did the Ten Commandments lessons, we talked about how things impact other things. And so our thoughts that we think will impact how we feel and what we do. What we do, our behaviors, impact how we think and how we feel. How we feel impacts how we think and how what we do. So all of these things in our role models and inside of us, all of these things are important because they impact the others, right? They all go together. So how big of an impact do these things play in your life? Okay, think about the time that you spend on media. Okay, when we were at seventh grade, when we were at Camp Four Springs, Mr. Nickel talked about how many hours people are on computers. And that's including for work, right? We're on computers all day or checking email. And now, if we go to this digital learning, we're on computers even more. So how much is that playing into your life? How much music? How much TV shows are you binge watching? Video games? Okay. How much do your friends impact your life? Those feelings, thoughts, and deeds. How much do you let church impact your feelings, thoughts, and deeds? Your parents, your family. So just kind of take a moment to reflect on that. So now that you've thought a little bit about that, let's think about the music one. Okay. This is always a surprising fact that we talk about. Okay. The people who are making the most popular music that usually has inappropriate topics or bad words, Eminem, Snoop Dogg, they don't let their children listen to it. They don't have their children have it on their phones or iPads. But yet they're selling it to children all over our country. But what message does it send to you that they don't have their children listen to it? They don't have their children have the music with inappropriate words. If we put those people up on the pedestal and have them be the role model, it kind of sends a signal that something's not right. So our first verse here, going with those role models and how we grow and what we do with our lives. Proverbs 4:23, above all else, guard your heart, for everything you do flows from it. Okay. So if we're putting in church and we're putting in Bible study and that's going in our heart, then good things flow from it, right? But if we're choosing those violent video games or music with inappropriate words, that's what's going in us, and then we get garbage out as well, right? I think the next slide is a video. Bear with me. Hopefully it plays correctly. I think it is set to play, and it should record and give you the sound. We'll see what happens. Thank you.
this is your new team philosophy?
What do you think?
I think this applies to all of life, not just football.
Well, that's my point. $10 for the person who can tell me who won the state championship a decade ago.
Walker Jennings.
No.
North Metro.
Stop guessing. You know it or you don't. How about 5 years ago?
Richland.
That was 3 years ago. You can't remember, can you? Leads me to ask a couple of questions. What's the purpose of this team?
Win ball games.
Then what?
We get a trophy and people talk about us.
Maybe, for a while. Then what?
I don't know. Get a scholarship, play for college, and coach Little League.
What are you getting at, Grant? You think we're just wasting our time?
If our main goal is to win football games, then yes.
You don't want us to win games.
No. Not if that's our main goal. Winning football games is too small a thing to live for. And I love football as much as anybody. But even championship trophies will one day collect dust and be forgotten. It's just that so far all this has been about us. How we can look good. How we can get the glory. The more I read this book, the more I realize life's not about us. We're not here just to get glory, make money, and die. The Bible says that God put us here for Him, to honor Him. Jesus said the most important thing you could do with your life is to love God with everything you are and love others as yourself. So if we win every game and we miss that, we've done nothing. Football then means nothing. So I'm here to present you a new team philosophy. I think that football is just one of the tools we use to honor God.
So you think God does care about football?
I think He cares about your faith. He cares about where your heart is. If you can live your faith out on the football field, then yes, God cares about football because He cares about you. He sent His Son Jesus to die for us so we could live for Him. That's why we're here. But see, it's not just on the football field. We've got to honor Him in our relationships, in our respect for authority, in the classroom, and when you're at home alone surfing the internet. I want God to bless this team so much people talk about what He did. But it means we got to give Him our best in every area. And if we win, we praise Him. And if we lose, we praise Him. Either way, we honor Him with our actions and our attitudes. So I'm asking you, what are you living for? I've resolved to give God everything I've got. Then I'll leave the results up to Him. I want to know if you'll join me. Your attitude's like the aroma of...
So that comes from Facing the Giants. And we're thinking about grow and how we live our life and how we need to live for Him, right? And so Coach goes in there and those things that... Who won the game 10 years ago? That's not what is important, right? What God's doing in your life and how you can share God with other people and how you take that word in and study His word is what's important and how you grow in your faith. So Hebrews 12. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith. For the joy set before Him, He endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of God, of the throne of God. Okay. We want to throw those things that are holding us back of this world off of us so that we can focus on God and Jesus. And right now, in the way that we're living and having to do this online offsite learning stuff, it's time to really focus on what's important and who's important, right? So how do we decide what in our life is the right and what is the wrong? And if we look at Jesus as the role model, if we think about that old saying of what would Jesus do, and think about that really, like use that truly, not just as a saying or a bracelet or whatever, that would be how we can know if it's right or wrong. Does it go with what God says or go against what God says? Does it help bring other people to Jesus or push them away? What we do with our life, is it a witness that's good or poor? One of the verses, I thought it was on the screen. We'll come back to this. Oh, I must have missed it. Oh, right there. It was at the beginning and I skipped it. Well, I want to go back to it because as we wrap up, I think it's important, this 1 Corinthians verse. Brothers, I could not address you as spiritual, but worldly. Mere infants in Christ, I gave you milk, not solid food. For you were not yet ready for it. Indeed, you still are not ready. You are still worldly, for since there's jealousy and quarreling among you, are you not worldly? Are you not acting like mere men? For when one says, I follow Paul, and another says, I follow Apollos, are you not mere men? What, after all, is Apollos? What is Paul? Only servants, through whom you came to believe, as the Lord has assigned each his task. I planted the seed, Apollos watered it, but God made it grow. So neither he nor who plants nor he who waters is anything, but only God who can make things grow. The man who plants and the man who waters have one purpose, and each will be rewarded according to his own labor. So when we think about that and what we've been talking about, how we live our lives, how we grow, how we study, what we choose to do, when we say cast off those things that are entangling us, it says here that I gave you milk, not solid food, because you weren't ready to take it yourself. You weren't ready to feed yourself God's word. And that's what confirmation is really all about, is that you are taking that step now to feed yourself God's word. It's not Sunday school and we're feeding it to you and telling you this is your transition time. And so we want you to be that follower of God that's living out your faith, okay? God is the one who makes things grow, not Paul, not Apollos, not who planted, not who watered, but God is all of it, right? So this last reflection that you can talk about with your family is think about what is something you want to keep in your life and what do you want to remove? If I can stop the screen share, I want to show you, I'm going to give you... There it is. Show you the home project and the work that you're doing with your family. Since you don't have a printed copy, I will be posting these files for you. There we go. Share this and share. Okay, so what you're going to do with your family is you kind of get to do two, because you would do your God huddle work together where you're working through a Bible study on Matthew. And then later this week or different night, your homework or your family work is to do a family devotion. So that could be really short and simple. You could find a resource online, a My Devotion, a teen devotion. You could just read your Bible with your family. And then what did you do in your family devotion together? What was involved? Did you pray? Did you sing? Did you read? Did you talk about what it means? Did you use the commentary? So that's that. Then down here is your memory work for next week after spring break. I will be sending out also with this a Google form for you to take last week's memory work. We trust that you are going to be honest and do it without looking. So you'll submit your memory work by typing in the blanks on the Google form, and then it will automatically correct it for you. And I want you to pick your Godhead leader from the list so that we can sort them and get that information to your leader. So thanks for bearing with us as we figure this all out and get you your confirmation work. Let's pray before we go. Dear Heavenly Father, in this time of uncertainty and figuring new things out, Father, we're glad that we can focus on you, that you are the guiding person that can take care of all of this, and that we can trust in you and keep our focus on you. Father, that as we study your word and grow in our faith, that the things of this world become less important than the things that you have for us are more important. Father, help us to continue to grow in your word so that we can be disciples and really show people what God is all about, what you are all about, what Jesus is all about, that we can be love and care to other people. Father, all this we pray in your name. Amen. Okay. Watch for the next lessons on the confirmation dates. Have a great day. I'll see you later.